Hey everybody, welcome back to Wagered on Tilt. I am T, and today we are going to be talking about player props. Now, what is a player prop? So a player prop is a propositional bet that you're going to be making with your sportsbook, and it will deal with a very specific stat. Now, that can be yardage, that could be receptions, that could be passes, yards run, how many goals, how many assists, how many rebounds. The list goes on and on and on by sport. So today we're going to do a simulator that's, again, very similar to the Monte Carlo. It's going to use a lot of the same type of logic and behavior, a lot of the same formulas. But in this, we're going to actually now include expected value so that we can calculate how much money are we going to get back, and is this really worth putting a bet down? Again, if you have something that has an 80% chance of winning, but the juice is too high, it's not really worth that bet. Whereas if the juice isn't really high, and maybe it's positive odds for you, and you're projecting around 40 to 50% chance, maybe roll the dice on that one, right? Because the outcome on the long haul is going to pay out more than if you constantly take the 80%. So today we're going to go through this. So yeah, enough of this. Let's go ahead and dive on into the prop betting tool, and hopefully we'll be able to find some winners. A player prop tool does use a Monte Carlo method, which is something we've learned in previous videos. But now we're going to actually cover it in more player-specific and individual athletes' capabilities. And we're going to use this information to try and really create a great model in understanding what is the probability of a specific event for a very specific player occurring. So in here, you're going to want to go ahead and create a spreadsheet in a very similar fashion to what I have here at the top. I wrote just prop calculator, so I know what this is. Over here, I have a name, points over, points percentage, under percentage, juice, the EV, which is expected value. Then over here, I have a target max, target min, target mean, target standard deviation, receptions percentage max, receptions percentage mean, receptions percentage min, reception percentage mean, reception percentage standard deviation. And then down here, I just have placeholders of name. Now, in this scenario, the way I have built the sheet is that I'm actually going to only be able to deal with 8 players at a time. I usually find that's more than enough. I only really need to do about 3 prop bets for different players, but I do like to go out to 8. Okay, so in setting up our sheet, we've gone ahead and filled out the titles that we're going to need. So here for the target max and target min, we don't need to do anything as of right now. But for the target mean, we're going to actually take the average of these two cells. We don't need to populate the data in here just yet, but I want to prep the formulas that I know I'm going to be using. So in here, what we're going to do is just go ahead and find the average of the target max and target min. So that will look like average, right, equals, and then we're going to say B2, come on Google, B2, 2, B3, save. All right, and you're going to get this thing that says div by 0, don't worry about it. It will change once you go ahead and update that. Now, I do like to use the dollar signs here to lock in the fields. That way, when I copy and paste it across the row, I know nothing's going to change, I don't accidentally break anything. And it all should work. So we're going to go ahead and paste this across the way. Bam, done. Next up, we're going to need to go ahead and get our next one, which is going to be our standard deviation. So again, we want to find the standard deviation. So we're going to go equal st dev. And then we're going to say from here to here. And again, same thing. We expect this to show us as div by 0, but that's okay. We don't have values in the upper hand yet. Once we get that information in there, then we'll be able to update that information. Next is reception percentage mean. And then as usual, I like to lock these in on their rows. Next, we need to get the standard deviation percentage. Standard deviation, and then it's just gonna be of B6 and B7. So B, dollar sign 6, to B, $7, lock it in, and we're going to take this over. Great. Now we have our formulas set up in here, and we're going to want to go ahead and look up some information. Let's go to Pro Football Reference and look up someone. So let's look up Tyreek Hill. All right, Tyreek Hill is going to be the person we're going to be doing our stats on today. So what we're going to do is then say T Hill into the name. And again, these are just placeholders so that I remember who I'm working with here. And it doesn't have to be this way. You can put it any way you want. Again, I just prefer the way I do these visually because it's easy to and quick to call these out. All right, so T Hill points over. So we're going to say that the book had him at 8.5 receptions for the game. So if he's at 8.5 receptions, what we're going to want to do is get his stats for his target max, target min, receptions max, and receptions min. As a reminder, this sheet is designed to handle almost any type of prop that you want. Again, I only like to use the last few years, right? 3 to 4, not 1 or 2. That's not enough information. But 3 to 4 years is usually good. You have a lot of players change out in different sports. Depending upon the lifespan of a player or a team, I like to grab different ranges of years. But if I'm going to do it, I have to be consistent for all player props that I'm running. I don't grab 2 years for this team and 6 years for this team and 3 years for this team. In the sport that you're selecting, you have to make sure that you're running all of the numbers the same. Otherwise, you're going to come up with some bad data. So here we're going to go ahead and look for Tyreek Hill's target maximum and minimum. Again, as a reminder, don't use the current season. You want to use the backwards looking information, not present. Present could have all kinds of weird anomalies that aren't going to flatten out. So we want to be able to capture the past information. We found the information that we need. So 2016, 83, 17 was 105, 137. So let's go back only 4 years, 135, 89, 137, 105. So we're going to take 137 and we'll go ahead and put that in there. So we already have that in there. Then let's go ahead and take a look at the reception percentage max. So we need to see how many times in 137 did he actually catch it. All right, we caught it 63.5%. So we're going to come in here, 0.635, right? So a percentage, remember, is a decimal. So this is 0.635. That is going to be that. For the max though, okay, that is not per game. So we're gonna need to divide it by how many games he played, which is 16, so 137 divided by 16. All right, and the good thing is you don't need to worry about changing that percentage because the percentage is already accounting for the entire season, which then actually is based on a per game basis, so we don't need to worry about that. So divided by 16, great. So on average, he was getting about 8.5 targets per game in that year. Now we need to find his minimum. What was the least that he did in the last 4 years? So he did 135, 89, 137, and 105. Okay, so he played 4 less games here and did 89. So this is where you have to decide how you want your data to be. We could take 89, divide by 12, and then get that as our minimum. Or we can go and say, no, we want to keep the numbers very consistent. Let's go look for where he had the same amount of games, or at least closer to the same amount, 15, 16 games. So for right now, though, we're going to just go with this. And we're going to say that he played 12 games and caught 89. So equal 89 divided by 12. Again, 89. All right. And in his 89, he had 65.2%. 0.652. All right. So now we're going to get all this information pumped in, which is great. And then now we need to go ahead and create a formula that we're going to run. So let's go ahead and enter in the information here. So what we're going to be doing is typing in equal norm INV. Again, same thing as Monte Carlo. And then we're going to type in rand for the random. And then I just put the parentheses because that way it knows it's that function. Then we're going to take the mean. Well, the mean, it's going to actually be this standard deviation, which will be B5. And we'll go ahead and lock that in place. Great. So right now it's saying he's going to be targeted on average about 6.823 times. I don't care about that. I need to know how many times he's going to likely catch it. So we're going to do the same thing and multiply it by now his catch percentages. Now we're going to go ahead and take the second formula and point it at the reception percentages. So we're going to take the mean percentage, great. And then we're also going to take its standard deviation, boop, right there. Again, I like to lock cells. So we'll go ahead and move this here, Click into here, lock that one up, lock that one up. Great. So a quick way to do this is if you just hit control down in the same column, you're going to go to the bottom. It's going to take you to 1,000. Well, I want to run more than that. So if you hit down, this little bar flies up and says, how many more do you want to add? Well, we're at 1,000, so I'm going to say 9,000. You don't have to be perfect. It doesn't. I know that we have cells above that are taking up additional points of data. You don't have to run exactly 10,000. Get close to 10,000. Now that you have your 10,000 rows, go ahead and go to the last one here. Paste in that formula. Again, we have everything locked up. Go ahead and click Control Shift Up. It's going to highlight that entire column. Hit Control V, and it's going to paste in. Now we need to do another formula. So I'm going to go ahead and now say equals if this number is greater than this number. I need to lock it because I'm going to be copying and pasting this formula all the way down. We're going to say 1, otherwise 0. So a 1 is true, 0 is false, and we'll go ahead and take a look. So did it actually get it? No, it didn't match it. So what we're going to do is copy and paste this formula all the way down. Now that we've gone ahead and copy and pasted the formula all the way down, let's go ahead and now kind of work out the percentages of times that it'll go over or it'll go under. So I'll go ahead and say equals for the over. Again, remember the formula said it's going over. So over is going to be count if, because we're going to count how many times j to j is 1. Okay, it's staying 0. And again, we did, let's just say, divided by 9,990. Because if you look over here, right, we started on 11. And we're saying we're running that many scenarios. And then I'm going to say here, equal, copy and paste the same formula over. When you copy and paste the same formula over, you're just going to switch out the 1 for a 0. There we go, and a 1. You're seeing a 1 because it's saying it's perfect, which, you know, it wouldn't really happen that way. So 8.5 seems pretty high. The model says it's 100% to go under. So let's go ahead and change this to a more probable option. So we'll say 5.5. How many times will it go 5.5? All right. Tools recalculating. There you go. Now we have a 75% chance to go under and a 24, almost 25% chance to go over. Now this is how the tool is really useful, is because now I can start trying to evaluate. So now let's go ahead and figure out what our expected value is based upon the juice. A decimal odd, okay, so in America we use minus 100, minus 250, minus 150, plus 350, plus 100, all those things. We need to convert it into a decimal. So the simple way to do this is that if it's a negative number, you're going to take 100 divided by that American odds and then subtract that value from 1. If it's a positive number, you're going to take that number, divide it by 100, and add 1. So this is a simple if-then statement that you can find in a Google Sheet. So if you want to copy this, I'd go ahead and hit pause right now on the video because it's kind of lengthy. And then the next thing you're going to do is multiply the outcome of that formula by the percentage chance that we're calculating of it going under. Again, I'm using the under percentage. If we wanted to do an over, what we'd need to do is then switch out the juice here, or you can add a new column for the juice over here. So let's go ahead and do that right now. So we're going to now say juice. All right. So we're going to kind of bookend the way this is pointing, and we're going to say that the juice for the over is going to be, you know, let's just make it pretty simple. We're just going to say it's a pick'em, which is 100. So where we have N2, we are going to change to Q2. All right, so is Q2 less than 0? No. So then it's going to run this calculation times L2 minus 1. And it's going to give us a negative 4.6%. That is not good. So it is still expected to go under the 5.5 receptions per game, and that is where you're going to find your value. Now we may see that, you know, there's high probabilities and things like that saying, oh, it's going to go over, it's going to go over. Again, depending upon the juice, that's really what's going to give you the expected value, because what expected value is the long haul of things. If I keep betting this thing over and over and over, am I more likely to make money betting the over or the under in the long haul? So if I can catch 1 in 100 times, and that one time though is worth $1 million, and the other 99 are worth one, well, obviously that one catch of $1 million is way better than the other 99 of one. And that's kind of a very high level and simplistic view of expected value. But again, it's over the long haul. So in this scenario, you would want to bet the under. Now you've got about a 47 on the under percentage, or as far as the expected value under. Your under percentage is 74, right? So let's even change this. We're going to say, what if it was 4? Over is going to be minus 300. It's going to run its calculation, right? You still have really good percentages on this. Now let's say this is 250, right? So they're going to say that Tyreek Hill is only going to make 4 catches. And they're saying if you're going to take the under, you've got 250. If you're going to take the over, it's minus 300. It's still worth taking the over, even at minus 300. So you can find some value in there. Again, you don't have to take that bet. Minus 300 is still pretty steep for something like that. So let's then see what it would be if it was 5. All right. So if we're at 5, there's still a 60% chance it's going to go over. But the juice is a positive juice, right? So you've got positive odds on this thing. So you're going to get a 39% expected return. Whereas over here, you actually have a negative value. So in the long haul, if you keep betting this thing over and over and over and over and over, you're going to lose money if you are betting those overs. So this is the simplistic way of doing this. And then what you do is then go ahead and fill in every single field of those prop bets that you want to make for those players. So that is it. If there's any questions, feel free to let me know. I'll answer anything in the comments that I can, and I'll post any videos on additional content that I can that anybody's looking for. So that is it from me. So everybody, happy wagering.